camera, yeah, okay. Hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty back for another show. It's funny, I can actually hear my dog walking around out there in the hall because I kicked her out because she wouldn't be like quiet while I drew this thing. So I can hear her out there waiting to come back in, but anyway, yeah, she usually sits under my table as I paint. I'm working on this Hulk drawing, like a rough, basically. I was gonna actually record later. I was drawing like crazy, trying to get as far as I could, because I kind of wanted to get to the part where I put the blacks and the whites on, because that's a little bit more interesting to watch. But then I realized it's like Tanya and my son, they kind of go to the park when I record these things. That's at least when I plan to record them most of the time. And if I waited any longer, I was gonna not have enough time to get a show in. So I had to just fire up the camera and go for it. And it's not, you know, it's kind of like, I don't know, for me, like, I always think that, like, at this point, the drawings don't look that great, you know, because a lot of it's, like, when I draw, it's sort of a, I don't know, especially when I draw, it's like, it's almost like a, I feel like it's like a pass, like, I do a pass, like, I do the initial sketch, and I usually sketch it with, like, one of these, that's kind of like this lighter area and stuff, so, like, in here where his neck is, and I don't really know what's happening. You know, sometimes I'll do this kind of thing. And, he's kind of got veins or tendons right there. His ear comes down. And then it drops. And then the shadow of his shoulder kind of picks everything else up and keeps it together. But anyway, that's what I do there. And then it's like I come in with the black color pencil when I want a little bit darker line, and I kind of go over it again and refine it, because I kind of know where this pencil's going to go now that I've made a sketch, so it's easier to kind of come in, because this is like so dark you can't really erase it much. I mean, if you really want something gone, you can get after it, but it usually messes the paper up somewhat. But and then, like, you know, once I do all this, it's kind of like, you know, like that kind of stuff doesn't look good. That doesn't look real great, you know, sort of amateurish over here. But then when I come back and hit it with the blacks, you guys can kind of compare if you want to later. Once I get this piece up, I'm sure it'll be on my website later. And you can kind of see what I mean. But like once I come back with the blacks, I'll actually black in and also kind of almost hit it with like a wash, you know what I mean? I'll be using the black paint, but then I'll just have a lot of water in it, and so some of it will kind of come in as a wash sometimes. And he's got some black here. It's kind of a hard piece because it's like the face, even though the face was, I was like, you know, looking at the face, I was like, I gotta get the face or it just isn't gonna work. And I feel like I've got the face to a point where I need it. Like, I think it's gonna work, probably. And then, it's like the rest of it's kind of just all on this face, you know what I mean? Even though this is cool and stuff, it's like, I mean, what I notice, like, with painting is, and this is, I'm not going to get all, like, esoteric or whatever, but I feel like it's, like, you know, like, whatever that focal point is, that's usually the thing that almost has the detail and carries the piece. And a lot of times I don't think even, like, all this even matters. Almost like I could just leave this piece alone right now and go, okay, it's the Hulk, you know, and people would, you know, still like it. But, so, I don't know where I was going with that, but it's just like this kind of detail and stuff. It's hard, in my opinion, kind of, because it's just, you know, it's like a field of detail. Like when you get out into here and you're doing like this kind of stuff, there's detail there, but it doesn't really mean anything. You know, it's not like the nose where you're like defining a nose so people recognize it as a nose. Like right in here, there's just as much light and shadow, but then it's it's just, I don't know, more unimportant, but still has to be there drawn, of course, but I tend to get lost in that kind of stuff. Not like I get off, you know, in there and not enjoy, you know, I mean, lost in the sense that, like, oh, yeah, I'm just noodling away forever and it doesn't matter. I meant, I'll get, like where I, you know, I'll be, like, drawing, like, this kind of stuff, and I'll lose my spot, in a way, like, between me and my reference. And then, it's just, you know, it's like when I draw fur or something, like if you're drawing like a wolf or something, it's the same thing. I have a hard time with that. But I just launched right into, like, you know, what I was thinking about with my art, which is cool. And I didn't really even think about, you know, kind of an intro for the show or anything. But thanks for watching my videos. And also, I actually did have a question. I really appreciate, like, all the comments that's happening right now, like on my site and on YouTube and, you know, wherever else, DeviantArt, Facebook. It's really cool. And, like, Sofera, for one, I really appreciate, you know, the support and that big old long comment you wrote. I just, like, reading that, it's just, like, really cool. I'm glad that, you know, you're getting that and something out of the videos, because I feel like I'm getting something too. Maybe the motivation to, not motivation, and I don't want to say courage, because it's like, that's different too, but it's a little bit like that. I feel like turning on the camera and, yeah, his hair is like a big thing. And I like to scribble in the blacks, too, because it's like, it shows me kind of the balance of the piece, you know. Some people don't really, they'll just leave their blacks out and just look at it like, oh, it doesn't matter. But it's like, I like to throw the blacks in, like right here, because that's like, you know, it's like balance. So there's going to be a black area over here. So it kind of tells you, like, where the contrast is. But I just, yeah, so far you're also, like, us, you know, on Patreon and stuff, and you're a great artist, and yeah, I just super appreciate, you know, just, I don't know, that comment and all the comments you've made, and just, you know, it's nice to meet people online and have friends and stuff. But I'm going to leave that arm alone because I just don't know what's happening there right now. Let's see, another, actually, I didn't have a lot of questions. I appreciate people's, like, feedback. You know, I'm trying to think of, like, some of them. Maybe I should look on my site real quick. I guess it doesn't much matter. One guy said I should tattoo. I appreciate that suggestion. You know, it's kind of like, whatever I do now, though, is kind of just, like, what I can do at the moment. You know, it's just like, I mean, you know, honestly, tattooing, it doesn't hold much interest for me. And it's nothing against tattooing. I really actually think, you know, like the stuff I see online and on people that I've met and stuff, it's like just incredible. It blows me away, some of these guys that are tattooing. And it probably is like a way you could make money doing art, but yeah, it's like, I don't know. For me to, like, pick up a new career or a new idea or something right now, it's not going to happen, you know. You got to have some kind of, like, love for what you're doing, you know, or, like, to me, like, passion or something, you know, especially like this. I mean, I don't know if I need a passion to paint houses, but, I mean, actually, I think if you're a guy who's, like, a good painter and wants to be, like, a, you know, have his own company and stuff like that, it is actually good to have a passion, because it separates you from all the guys who don't. And, I don't know, at times I've actually had a passion for that kind of work. But I do appreciate that comment of the tattooing. And I'm trying to think of, like, some of the other ones. There was one guy that asked, do I use photo reference when I draw the movie stuff? And let's see, his belly comes this way. And it's like, yeah, I totally use reference. Let me show you, like, this whole piece. I got a picture here that I'm drawing from.
And I actually usually print out a couple, because, like, this picture's so dark, and then I did one that's really washed out so I could see the detail in his eye and stuff. And I just keep those around the drawing, and I look at them, and use them, you know, use them as reference. And I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Like, I guess there. I don't think there's really anybody that does realistic portraits without reference. I mean, I don't really know if it's possible. I mean, I know, you know, like, I can draw, like, out of my head. It doesn't look quite the same. You might have seen it before. I mean, every now and then I'll put something up that's not in the same vein of, like, movie art. But, I mean, you know, if you're doing portraits of, like, movie stars, you know, people want them to look like the movie star. So it's just a... It's a real good idea to, you know, get some reference and do it right, you know. And I also kind of think that, I mean, I've come to sort of a conclusion. Wait a sec, let me sharpen my pencil. I always hate that when, like, I sharpen it up and then, like, the first swipe I break the tip off. But what was I saying now? I can't really remember what I was talking about, but I mean, I was talking about photo reference, but beyond that, I think that, like, what I've, like, with my style and stuff, I'm not saying that, you know, everybody should use photo reference or whatever. I'm actually, I like a lot of stuff that's not like that, you know? Like Sam Keith's work and, you know, like, I know Frank Frazetta said he didn't use photos. I don't know if that's 100% true or not, but, you know, I mean, I like a lot of different kind of art, but, you know, like, when I look at my stuff and, like, how I draw and how I've developed, and I almost look at, like, when I draw without photo reference, like, and even though they can get pretty finished, that they're kind of just like the sketch in a way for something like this piece. And I wish I had some stuff out to show you examples, but yeah, I don't look at that stuff as like it's as finished. Almost like I could draw out the sketch for something, and then I'd kind of go and later get, there's one of my videos that's, it's called, this book called Teddy and the Yeti, and I did a card for that guy, that does this comic called Teddy and the Yeti, and in that video, I explain, like, when I have illustration jobs where I don't have any kind of reference, it's not like a movie art job or anything, and I explain how I put it together to make it look like the rest of my art, you know. And, like, with his thing, it's like a comic book, so I knew what the characters looked like and stuff, but I didn't have any kind of reference. So I photographed myself, and I went around and looked for photos of stuff on the internet and in movies that kind of fit. So I made, like, a Yeti that kind of looked like what I would think a Yeti looks like. I didn't make him, but I found, like, different photos. So I had kind of, like, I pulled some reference from, like, some of the, actually, like, the orc faces from Lord of the Rings that look kind of Yeti-ish, and just, you know, I drew them, I used that as the reference for the face, and then, like, for the fur, I found some hairy creature, I don't remember what now, but I show a lot of the photos that I kind of drew from to make that piece work as a whole, you know? So, I mean, I think, personally, that photo reference is awesome, and I think it's not, you should never look at it like it's a crutch, or like, oh, I'm cheating or something, because it's, I mean, for one thing, it's kind of weird, because you get into this, now I'm getting off on a real rabbit hole, but I mean, with like comics especially, you know, you get into this thing where people are like, I don't know if it's like ego or what, but they're like, you know, you gotta be able to draw out of your head and all that kind of stuff all the time, and then, but like, you get, you know, like one step out of that into like the art world, And by that I mean like any kind of portrait artist or landscape artist or any of that, you know. And it's like, what are they doing? They're all drawing from like life, you know. And then you also, you take like a step back in history, like in my opinion, like illustration, like that's some of the best art that's, you know, been created, you know, well, really ever, but, you know, like Norman Rockwell and J.C. Lydecker and all those guys, you know, I mean, I love all that work, and you look at, like, what they were doing, and it was like, none of them were drawing from out of their head. They were drawing from, they would set up models, and, either paint straight from models. I mean, if you ever find anything about J.C. Lydecker, he actually had models that would come to the studio and pose, and he had costumes, and also, who's that other guy? Andrew Wyeth's dad, I can't remember his name. N.C. Wyeth, that's his name. He had, you know, there's like lots and lots and lots of pictures of his kids dressed up in, you know, his big costume, what would you call it? I don't know. I want to say a trunk, but I bet it was more than a trunk, you know, and they would be out playing as Robin Hood and stuff in these costumes because that's the kind of stuff he painted and the kind of stuff he collected so that he could paint that stuff, you know. And and Norman or N.C. Wyeth, his mentor was Howard Pyle, and I'm sure Howard Pyle was the exact same thing because he taught him how to paint, you know. I think it's kind of weird that like now, you know, here it is like 100 years later, and you got people, you know, really, you know, oh, you can't use photo reference. I just go out of my head, and that kind of stuff. And I think it's, I don't know. I don't want to, you know, say anything against it because I also will do that. I'll just, you know, grab something and paint out of my head. But it's, you know, with me, it was always kind of like trying to figure out what, you know, because I didn't go to school or anything, but just kind of trying to figure out how to do it. So I kind of really tried like a lot of, not really styles, but you know, I would get off on like Frank Rosetta Kick was like my first kind of artist that I really kind of looked at and was like, oh yeah, I want to be like him, you know. And so you kind of start painting a little bit like Frank Rosetta for a while, and that was a lot of like where I got that whole like, oh, you know, because I remember just reading like specifically out of this an interview with him, you know, he said like, you know, well, that's what separates the men from the boys is you know, guys who can just sit down with a blank piece of paper and draw it. And I took that to heart, you know, and for a while I was like that. I'm like, I've got to learn how to draw just straight out of my head, blah, blah, blah. And later, I think I started to realize, you know, when I was trying to learn how to paint too, there wasn't the internet, which it's kind of amazing what you can find on the internet. I remember just, you know, hunting and hunting for stuff by Wyeth or books by, you know, books that had Howard Pyle in them and you know, stuff like that. It was so hard to find any of the kind of those kind of illustrators, Dean Cornwall, and even like Drew Struzan was one that was just super hard to find any kind of book on. And you know, I would buy like the book covers he did and all that kind of stuff and just collect them because I was a fan and you know, trying to kind of learn his technique and stuff. But anyway, I don't know where I was going with that. That thing, you know, like Frazetta said, and I think too, the fact that I immediately kind of gravitated toward comics, because I couldn't really figure out where the heck there was any other kind of work, you know. I went to college for a little while because I just thought, yeah, that's what I need to go to college. But then I got there, and, you know, I kind of went to it was called the Colorado Institute of Art and Design, and
It just was like an advertising school, and you know, they were kind of teaching us how to like design cereal boxes, so I took off, got out of there. But you know, it's just like I was just self-taught, and so I was just kind of trying to figure out, you know, what I needed to figure out.
The thing is, like with Frazetta, like now, and especially with the rise of the internet, and it's like all of a sudden all of these kind of candid photos come out and things like that, and you see like places that he actually swiped figures from and things, that I wonder if, and I don't mean that in any kind of derogatory way, but there's paintings that he took figures out of,
and you know, they're just obscure paintings that I never heard of or seen, and so let's see, this goes this way and it comes back. Hang on a second. Let me do this thing. This is kind of what I'm talking about. Like, when I did my sketch, I sketched this in. I didn't really sketch all this. So, my brother always says, like, my technique is, like, I draw, like, a million lines. And then I just, well, I used to say I erase everything but the ones that are like the right ones, and I think that is true. But I don't really erase anymore. I really actually don't hardly erase. It's funny, but what I do is I just darken up the right ones. I don't know. So like that, and then you got this piece coming right here. I used to go to a ton of like life drawing. This is all kind of like going back to that whole thing about photo reference and should use photo reference, and I guess I'm like talking about it in the perspective of like, you know, the guy who asked the question, and if you're trying to learn how to draw or something, so like I'm giving you kind of the perspective of like how I came to my thoughts about photo reference, and also just the way I use them, I guess. So that's like a good example though of just, you know what I mean? It's like, some people call this like a gesture, but it's like a rough, I just threw it in where I thought it should be, and when I come back now, I'm looking to get it a little closer to where it should be. And I mean, I could slow way down to like, you know, turtle speed kind of thing, and just shade and render every little bit. But this is actually just a rough sketch, and I'll tell you guys what I'm doing it for later, but I mean, that's kind of what I actually consider these to be, is just my roughs, so I kind of need to get this done in, you know, a couple hours, rather than spending like a few days on it like I do my paintings. So let me think. Where was I at with the whole photo reference thing, though? I was talking about Frazetta and possibly swiping, but as time went on, with like the internet and kind of seeing that kind of stuff, it made me kind of realize, and not just the internet, I mean other books and stuff, but it made me realize, like, especially discovering like the old illustrators, but it's like it made me realize how many of these guys and how much of these guys like were, I just loved their work and was like, man, it's like if I could paint like that, you know, used photos. And I mean, one of the big ones is J.C. Lydecker, who I love his work, I love his brother's work, but I mean especially his. If you can ever find any books or look that up online, that's something to look at. And you look at his style, he has such a, like, a super kind of romantic style. It's very, you know, it's got a lot of, like, texture to the paint. You can really see the brush strokes. I mean, it's a very imitative style. You see it now when somebody's sort of trying to imitate, like, an older type illustration style. But, see, now I love that. See, because it's like you got the darks, and they're all kind of coming in, then this, which is not, that's not super dark, but like when I come back with the paint, gonna paint that in there, and then there's gonna be just a real intensity there. And you got this, and then it's gonna look pretty good, I think. But anyway, like what I was saying about Lydecker, is Lydecker, and I'm trying to think where I read this. I'm pretty sure I read it in, and this is an awesome book if you're trying to learn how to draw and paint and stuff like this. And it's so funny that it's just fallen out of, you know, like people just don't know about it. But the Norman Rockwell's autobiography, and it's he wrote it himself, and it is super interesting. And I had an old copy, and it's so funny. I remember I loaned it to a friend of mine, and he still got it. And we're not really friends anymore. I haven't seen that guy in years, so kind of sucks. But that book is just, you know, and people go, oh, he wrote it kind of like so that he's, you know, he's always right and everybody else is wrong kind of thing, you know. And that's not really true, but it's kind of like it is from a perspective of like, it's almost like reading like the Bob Newhart show, where he's kind of like Bob Newhart, and then everybody else he knows is crazy. but it's actually a really funny read. But he talks about J.C. Lydecker and his brother, and when he first met them, and they were kind of before him. You know, they were famous illustrators when he was wanting to be an illustrator. And he talks about, you know, meeting them and going to their house and just, like, how rich they were back then. Like, because it was the time of the illustrator back then. There weren't cameras. They came on when Norman Rockwell was around. But, I mean, you know, in Lydecker's time, that was getting back to where, you know, it's like the, I think it's called, like, the tin type, you know, and the big, they hold the thing up and it poofs and, you know, pull out the slide. It's like almost like the old West times, you know. So they weren't taking photos. But Lydecker, he talks all about how Lydecker was really against, like, photographs when they first came on. And how he just, he hated artists that that would just use photos. And he talks about this one time he went to his studio. And it's been a long time since I read this, so hopefully I don't screw the story up. But he talks about how Norman Rockwell was basically painting away, and he had, you know, a bunch of photos laying all over the place, which is, that's like my technique too, you know. It's just, when I have to draw something I don't have photo reference for, I have, you know, I might pose myself, I get stuff off the internet, and I just have it laying everywhere, and you're just kind of making this Frankenstein's monster out of all these things. And, but anyway, Lydecker came over, and he saw all the photos laying all over the place on, Rockwell Studios floor, and he, you know, didn't approve. But anyway, you know, that's, to me, that's so telling in a way, especially with the style that Lydecker had, because he, you know, he is such a kind of a painter. I mean, he's got that painterly style, but when you think about it, you know, if he was painting, and he's also a guy who did a million roughs, he would do full paintings before he would do a painting. So he would, you know, like, oftentimes you can find paintings that are, you know, close to finished or actually painted twice, basically. Because he painted one and he, you know, and it was either a rough or he didn't like it and he just painted another one. But also what I was going to say is, you know, and I guess he could have been actually working off of studies. I know, like, Michelangelo and Rembrandt did that kind of stuff where they'd have a model come and they would work up a study and then paint that later. But I was going to say, though, is like when you look at his style and it's so painterly and stuff, and it's almost like if you were to go to a life drawing class and, you know, get out a canvas and stuff and do a painting in the amount of time that they could stand there. So, like, you know, like when I used to go, you know, they a lot of times have an hour pose, or sometimes I'd even go to some life drawing classes that would do like a 3-hour pose, and I would actually bring my paints and do a painting. But I mean, you know, they're very rough, they're very quick, and hang on a sec. Okay. I heard somebody pull up outside. but they're very rough, they're very quick, and, you know, they're painted like a guy who could be painting right from, you know, right from a model, like right in front of him, and that means, you know, he'd have to get that sucker done. You know, he couldn't be wasting time noodling this and that, because how long can a person stand there for you, you know? So that's some really cool stuff. But anyway, like, back beyond all that stuff, what I was talking about with photo references, that's kind of one of the things that I discovered later, is so many of the great, great artists that, in my opinion, I think did probably influence Frazetta. I really think that Dean Cornwall and J.C. Lydecker and that kind of stuff, I mean, obviously he saw that kind of stuff. That stuff was getting published, like, when he was a kid. You know, whatever that magazine Norman Rockwell worked for, that was a super popular magazine back then. Was it Life? I don't remember. But, I mean, I think he probably had to be somewhat influenced by them. And it's just, anyway, like, what I was going to say is, like, that was the way you did it back then. I mean, that's how those guys were taught to paint. And, you know, before, like the 60s or whatever, late 50s, came in and started, like, blowing the hell out of all the traditional art. And so many of the old methods were just lost to time, you know. That was just, like, what you did. And also, I think about that, one of the things about that Norman Rockwell biography that's just amazing, autobiography, is like when he talks about going to art school, and he basically went to an illustration school or somewhere, I don't remember where he went, but it was like one of the big ones at the time, and his anatomy teacher was George Bridgman, and, you know, if you're an artist and you know anything about anatomy, that's like, you know, probably the most famous anatomy book guy there is George Bridgman. And you know, Norman Rockwell learned his anatomy hanging out with that guy, you know. It's pretty crazy. But, you know, it too, just, I mean, I don't know, when I read that kind of stuff too, I almost felt like, man, I really came at it from a backwards way of painting. You know, if you could have been born back then, and even though, you know, it's like way better to be born now, because you got the internet, for crying out loud, you know, you got a place to sell your work, you got a place to basically do anything, you know, start your comic book company, whatever. And back then it was like you had to go to New York and, you know, live there pretty much, because I don't think there was even like FedEx back then. But, what was I going to say? But back then also, though, like, one of the pluses, or at least from what I took of it, and I mean, you know, it's probably tough to really be able to even get to one of those schools or go to college back then, but, you know, that the fact that there was schools like that, you know, when I was younger, there was like a real, you know, like, when I was looking around at the Colored Institute of Art and stuff, and later I've heard of guys, I remember listening to an interview with George Pratt, and he was talking about going to whatever that school in New York he went to, and I was like, that was like a real art school. That's really where you could learn how to paint, and they really taught people how to paint. But I mean, like, when I couldn't find a school like that, you know, I grew up in like a little farm town, and there just wasn't, I mean, I never even thought about going to college until my art teacher was just like, you have to go to college, and she got my dad in there, and was just like, you know, railing him, her and the counselor, being like, you're crazy if you don't let this kid go to college, you know. And my dad was like, browbeat into, you know, filling out the financial aid, you know, stuff or whatever. But I don't know, I didn't make it anyway. I dropped out, like, you know, a few months later, so, when I actually did get to school. But I don't know, you know, the thing is like, I went to the wrong school, you know. It's there was no way that I was ever going to be happy doing whatever the heck they were teaching me, ad design or whatever. So I don't know. And I also, I did, you know, get into comics later, and it wasn't that much later, and things like that, and I worked. So it wasn't necessarily the wrong decision. I don't know. But I, you know, I couldn't, I mean, I remember seeing, like, an ad for, like, the Joe Kubert School, which is, like, the comic book school, and I think that was, like, the only one back then, you know. And, I'm not even sure if, like, I have a friend that went to the Joe Kubert School. I don't even know if he's actually got a degree from that. You know, I think that back then it might not even have been, like, an accredited college, but maybe it was. I don't want to put, you know, say that it wasn't if it was, but, I probably would have done a lot better if I went to a school like that and been interested and stuck it out. But, you know, I mean, I don't think we drew. And we did a little bit of drawing. But, you know, we were, I mean, and it was, plus it was pre-computer everything. So, and we were actually learning how to hand letter stuff, you know, like ads and stuff. And, you know, they didn't have even like the, we weren't even doing the computer thing at that point, so even if I just stuck there, I probably would have been just immediately, you know, back out. I don't know what I'm saying. College just didn't work out for me, and it didn't matter to me either, because I think I did fine without it. But that whole thing was just, you know, just trying to give you my perspective on photo reference. I think it is good to use. But if you want to be a cartoonist or something, or whatever, if you got, like, in your head to be, you know, H.R. Giger or something, you know, it's like, maybe you don't need photo reference. There's definitely more than one way to skin a cat, and that's all there is to it, you know. So I wish I could have got this piece further along for you guys. Let's look. I forgot, there's no timer on my camera, so I don't know how long I went for. I hope this one kind of made some sense, and I always have this fear now that like what I'm talking about is just a bunch of rambling nonsense that makes no sense, and people are just going to be like, this guy is nuts. But when I listen to him later, I'm like, yeah, that wasn't that bad. So anyway, that's the video for today. I'll do another one tomorrow. And have a good one, guys. See ya.